Hey, thanks for joining us today. We're in a new series called Quit Church, because your life will be better if you did. I hope you enjoy it today.
Hey, amen. I'm glad you guys are here. I'm going to pause and just welcome our online audience as well, and those tuning in for Quit Church Part 3. And in this series, we've been looking at how culture is influencing us in our relationship with God and in our relationship with the body of Christ, and how probably in ways that we didn't even know. And that's what I think that the Apostle Paul was meaning in Romans chapter 12 when he says, don't conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. And if we're not intentional, conforming actually happens accidentally. You know that, right? That's literally what conforming is. It's an accidental patterns that are developed because it's going with the flow. It's what naturally kind of happens. And I think what has happened is that our relationship with God, like the way it was supposed to look like and what it is, and what the Word of God says about that, and the Word of God says about the body of Christ, is a lot different than what we see in the church today. And so we've kind of read some different startling statistics. A couple weeks ago, I told you that every Sunday, statistically, like today, 92 churches are closing their doors forever. Like, because there's a lot of people quitting church. They're giving up on church entirely. I was reading some more statistics to share with you guys. In most churches, 80% of the work is being done by 20% of the people. Isn't that crazy? Not here at Discovery Church, though, thank God. We have over 60% of our church connected to a dream team. Give it up for the dream team, guys. Come on. You guys are awesome. But here's some more. 39% of active believers consider the Bible as the literal word of God. Only 39%. So we're doing a series next year. We already have it planned on the Bible, the Word of God, why you can trust it, where did it come from, how do you study it. We're going to dig into and educate the body of Christ and what is the Word of God. 39%, man, less than 20% of professing believers practice God's principles for giving. Less than 5% of believers share their faith with an unbeliever. It's startling. More than half of all church members attend church once a month or less. Something's got to change, you guys. Something has got to change in the way that we are doing this thing called faith. And the way that we're in our relationship with God and our relationship with the body of Christ. Casual attendance, casual Christianity, casual church is tearing apart churches. It's closing doors. It's tearing about churches brick by brick all over this nation. Casual approach to our relationship with God. So something's got to change. And in this series, this is what I believe needs to change. It's through this little idea right here. We need to quit. That's the solution, I think, to our problems and our relationship with God and what we're seeing with the church and how many people are just giving up on it. We need to quit. Can you imagine what our life would be like if we just bought into fully the principles of God's word? If we just kind of quit this casual, comfortable relationship, Christianity, and actually bought into the principles. A revival would break out, okay, in our church, in our nation, if the people of God would just buy in to the principles and quit that cultural, casual, comfortable Christianity that we've become accustomed to. So in this series, we've done a few different topics. So the first week was quit expecting to wake up in heaven. So that's one thing we need to quit. Quit expecting earth to be heaven. It was never meant to be that way. And I think that's what kind of, again, it's this culture's influence. Like, the influence of culture is on every one of us. We feel this tension. Get what you want and get it now. Have it now. If you want it, get it now at any cost. Go into debt, whatever you need to do, but get what you need, get it now. This idea of trying to get your everything now, making earth, you're not supposed to get everything now. There is a future home in heaven where every tear is wiped away and there is no sorrow and death and the sting is gone. That's our future home, heaven, and this is not heaven. So we need to quit that and quit expecting the church to be heaven and perfect, because the only perfect person in church is Jesus, okay? So that was week one. Week number two last week was quit your church friends. Quit, because we all have these siloed relationships. We have these superficial relationships with church. Our cultural, the way we do church is 70 minutes on a Sunday and, you know, compartmentalizing your life. This is where God is and where church is, and everything is where I do my work, and this is where my real friends are, and this is my family, and everything's compartmentalized. And that's not the way it was supposed to be. There is so much more that God has called you to and for in your life and in your relationship with others in community. It isn't kind of passing by with superficial relationships, church friends. God created you for authentic community. He created you to have deep, authentic relationships. So if before you go up and quit church, try it first, okay? Quit expecting to wake up in heaven. Quit the church friends. Go a little bit deeper, you guys. This is one of the scriptures I think we shared because we're all members of one body. I mean, we belong to one another. God has called us to belong. And when I say this word members, what comes to mind in our culture, in our society today, is this idea of membership, like 24-hour fitness. You're a member of the club or something. This is not what God means. God's not all, you're in the club now, man. You're in my club. That's not the membership, the member that he's talking about here. He's talking about a family member, that you are part of the family of God. Actually, the depiction is of the body of Christ, that we have these members of our body. Each, they're separate, but they're essential, necessary components and pieces to the body of Christ, that they all play a specific role in our body. Let me tell you a story, kind of, and I'll tell you where we're going today, but let me first tell you this story. A couple months ago, my wife and I, we had dinner at a friend's house, and it was a great time. Had great laughs, and when it came time to like clean up and stuff, we started cleaning up with them, and they're like, no, you're our guest. No, you don't have to, and we're just, no, it's okay. So we're just cleaning up with them, throwing stuff away, putting away dishes and stuff, and the whole time, they're like, oh, thank you so much. Oh, thank you. You don't have to, but thank you, and oh, and it was just because we were their guests. And as we leave and we pull up to our house, pull up in the driveway, I notice my trash can is still out on the street. It's empty. It's been there for a couple days now. So I'm like, okay, let me go grab that thing and take it back. And I take it back to the side of the house. And I go in. Veronica's already in. She's doing dishes. So I just go there. And I'm helping with some dishes and helping cleaning up around the kitchen. And we're just talking about the evening, talking about, like, you know, what we enjoyed and having some laughs and stuff. And what dawned on me was that not one time did my wife go, oh, no, you don't need to do that. Or she didn't go, after I came in from taking the trash, like we were in the trash can after 2 days being out on the street, she didn't go, oh, thank you, honey, you didn't need to do that. You know why? Because it's my house, that's why. And that's what you're supposed to do in your house. When I was in our friend's house, I was a guest in their house. So no, it's okay. No, dude. Oh, thank you. But in my house, you ain't get that. That's what she's supposed to do. You better help me clean, okay? Finally, you took out the trash. You brought it back or whatnot, okay? Because look, in that mindset, we try to do this with our kids and get them to think this way, don't you? How many of you ever had the parental speech with your children where you tell them something like this, where you say, you're a member of this family. As long as you're living in this house and you're part of this family, you will do your part in this house, right? I know I'm not the only one who smells that. Yeah. Come on, I saw you walk over that. Okay, that piece of trash been sitting there, all right? So what are we trying to do in that conversation? Some of you need to have that conversation. You haven't had it yet, okay? That conversation needs to happen, all right? What we're trying to do is get the child to shift their mindset, right? From thinking mom and dad do everything to I'm a part of this family. And I have a part to play, all right? So that mindset creeps into the church. That entitled mindset that we kind of think of ourselves as guests in the house when God has called you family, that you actually belong. You're a member of the house. You smell that too. Come on, you see that? You see that? You belong. And we treat the relationship with the body of Christ in the church as this transactional guest experience. It's where I go to church to get something for me or even to give a little bit and then check back out. It's this transactional guest mindset that exists in our culture that you need to quit. You need to quit. So let me say it this way. Quit helping out. Quit helping out. No, it ain't. No, you belong. You're not called just help out. You're not called I can help. No, you're part of it. That's not help. That's what you're supposed to. You belong to the house. You're part of the family, okay? If you are a believer in Jesus Christ and Discovery is your church and you're not helping out, you belong, okay? That's That's what you need to quit. That mindset of I'm just helping out needs to. It produces some things that are not natural to a disciple. Produces some things in the people even that we are helping that is not intended. You guys got to get this. You have to get this. This is so huge, you guys. Let me show you. Because when you help, it's because you see weakness. Oh, I can help. Oh, I can help there. I think I can help you. Anyone ever told you, you need help? Don't admit it. How many of you have ever told somebody, you know, that person, or said, they need help, okay? So when you see that someone needs help, you may see yourself as superior, right? As they're needy, they're weak. I can help there. And God has not called you just to help weak people. That's not, no. And there's another form of helping that I call fixing. But when you fix, it's because you see brokenness. You see, and fixing someone or fixing something, whenever you set out to fix something that's broken or someone that's broken, it's you're judging that thing or someone. It's a judgment. And anything that you judge or cast judgment on, you can't be, there's disconnection. There's a disconnection between anything that you are judging. You can't be close, but look. Serving. When you serve, you see value. See, it is impossible to be disconnected from something or someone that you're serving. It is impossible. You have to be profoundly connected to someone to be able to serve them. Fixing is disconnection. Even helping, when you go out on a mission trip or you go out to the Dream Center and you're going to serve someone, they'll tell you. And then you go on a mission trip, they'll tell you, don't apologize for the people's lifestyle here. Don't say you're sorry. Don't do. This is their life. Because what you're doing when you see people that I'm here to help you because you're weak, you are diminishing them. Their integrity, their life, their wholeness. Oh, I can help you. Oh, I think I can help you. I'm here to help you. No, that's not what you're called to do, to help just weak people or fix people's broken issues. No, you're to see value in every person and serve them. And serve them. There's a huge difference. See, well, what's? I'll show you the difference. I'm gonna show you the difference of when you don't quit helping, there is some outcomes that are going to happen in your life. Some things will be produced in you when you're just helping out. If you don't quit, you guys. And then I'm gonna show you what happens when you actually start serving and the benefits of serving as well. Because Jesus said this in Matthew 23. He said, "The greatest among you will be your servant." It's like an upside down, again, countercultural. It doesn't go with the flow. It doesn't go with the custom, the flow of culture. Jesus said, no, it's upside down. It's not the pyramid this way like culture. If you want to be great, Jesus says, then you're going to be the servant of all. You're going to be the greatest servant. So let me show you what happens. Let me show you what happens. If you don't quit, helping out, this is what's going to happen to you guys. All right, here's the first. Take some notes. Number one, helping becomes self-seeking. You'll eventually come to this place where you go, what is this doing for me? Oh, what am I getting out of this? Because if you're just helping out, I'm telling you, even if you don't start out there, you'll eventually get to this place where it comes back to you. And that's why you need to quit. Let me show you an example in the scriptures in Mark chapter 10. There was a story. It was actually right before the feeding of the five. We'll get into it. But there, Mark chapter 10, Jesus is trying to explain to his disciples the scenario that's about to come. He says, we're going up to Jerusalem, guys, and the Son of Man, I'm going to be delivered to the chief priests and to the teachers of the law. So he's trying to soften the blow. Hey, guys, I'm going to be condemned to death. I'm going to be handed over to the Gentiles. They're going to mock me, spit on me, flog me. They're going to kill me, you guys. And he's pouring out his heart to the disciples. But 3 days later, I'll rise. And there's this moment. And here we get a glimpse. Watch this. We get a glimpse into the mind of people who are just trying to help out. James and John, the sons of Zebedee, came to Jesus and said, Teacher, that sucks for you and all, but we want you to do for us whatever we ask. Can you picture this with me? Jesus is pouring out his heart. I'm going to die. I'm going to go to the cross. He's having a moment with his disciples, his inner circle. I can see the tears welling up in his eyes. And right after that, just, okay, shut up now, Jesus. Shut up. Be quiet. Okay. No, seriously, that's how disrespectful this is. Like, and Jesus goes, what do you want me to do for you? Are you kidding me? What do you want me to do for you? Jesus asked, and they replied, let one of us sit at your right hand and the other at your left in your glory. How presumptuous. You know, so these disciples were, they were with Jesus for years at this point, and they missed it. You know why? Because they were just helping out. That's why. They were just, they were helping the kingdom of God, helping build the kingdom of God, but they had no ownership in the kingdom of God. Oh man, that was so much better than you guys gave me some credit for. Man, I need you to get this. Because this is why, this is what'll keep you on this sideline of just helping out in your transactional relationship of fixing and helping and ducking in and ducking out kind of flow that God never intended. You can't help build God's kingdom, but he has called you sons and daughters in the kingdom. And if you don't take ownership as a son of the house, as a daughter of the house, then you'll get to this place of a self-seeking relationship and whatever you put your hand to. And these guys did it. And that's why, look at this. Membership assumes rights. That's what we think of. When we think of membership, we think of, what's my rights? Well, if I have a membership, that means I can lift these weights. I can run on that treadmill. I can come during these hours. I got membership. I got rights. But Jesus is trying to shift their understanding to not just membership, but an ownership mentality. That's what it means to be part of the family. That's what parents are trying to teach your kids and to teach you guys. You have ownership in this house, man. I ain't the only one supposed to clean up and do the dishes. Come on, somebody pick up this house. It's your house. Ownership assumes responsibilities. Membership assumes rights. All right? So it becomes, helping just becomes self-seeking. And maybe that's not where you're at. Maybe you help out for the right reason. You know it's for others. But if you're just still helping out, it might get here where helping becomes a task. How many, let's admit, I've gotten here where helping become a task. It's just like, it's a checklist. It's my duty. It's my assignment. It's where I'm scheduled kind of thing. It just becomes a little check-in, check-out kind of thing. And it will eventually become a task if you're just helping out, you guys. Here's what the Bible says about that in Romans chapter 14, verse 15. Here's now where the disciples are about to experience the miracle, the feeding of the 5,000, one of the most well-known miracles that Jesus performed. It was, you know, and the disciples, listen, they almost missed it. They almost missed out on the greatest miracle. Look, it says, as evening approached, the disciples came to Jesus and said, this is a remote place, Jesus. You know, everyone wants to help out until it gets hot. You ever notice that? Oh, I feel called to this place to serve in the Dream Center in this pantry. Let it get 100 degrees. I'm out. This is a remote place, and it's getting late already. I mean, we've already handed out all the sermon notes. Service is over, man. I'm hungry. Send the crowds away, all right? We're done. We've done our part. Let them go eat. We're going to eat ourselves. Well, we ain't got enough for them. They need to go feed themselves. They go to the village and buy themselves some food. Listen, I wonder how many miracles we've missed out on because we're just helping out instead of serving. Because there was a miracle right here in the making. And here they were in this help out mentality. And if you are just helping out, if you don't quit this, I'm telling you, Jesus has miracles that you are a partaker in, that he wants to invite you into, that when you're just helping out, you won't experience. But if you'll see value in people, value in the house, value in the assignment even, I'm telling you, you start serving, he'll start including you in the miracle in the making. Because he says, you guys know the story. He prays for those loaves and fishes, and he says, here you go, you hand them out. This is your miracle. Hand this out, guys. How many miracles have we missed out on because we said, I'm done. I've done my task. There, I'm done. I've done my duty. And we miss it. We miss the miracle. Here's another what happens when we're just helping out. Helping becomes a source of burnout. How many ever been here? Okay, we're just, you got no more to give. It just is depleted. You see, when we're just helping out because they're weak or that's broken or I can fix that and I have what they need over here. We're just helping out. You will get to the end of yourself, but when you can serve God, he will give you a power, an anointing, a grace that you cannot fabricate yourself. That's why you see people, I see people serving on Sunday. They're worshiping one and serving like two services. They're doing small groups. They're doing the Dream Center. They're all about it. And they're just got on fire, passionate for God, man. And someone can serve one time a month and be like, I'm tired. You know why? Because you just helping out. You see yourself as a guest in the house and not part of the family. That's why. Because when you're serving God, it'll add energy, strength, and passion back into you, man. It will. You can't outserve God. You can't. When you're serving, when you're helping out, you'll get to, if you don't quit helping out, you'll burn out. You will. You'll get to the end of it, like in Malachi chapter 3. It says, you've said it's futile to serve God. Like your perspective, when you're burnt out and you're coming to the end of yourself, your perspective starts to change. The people that you're trying to help out because they're broken or they need, and they need to be fixed or they're weak, you start looking at them like with disdain now when you got no energy left, right? When you're depleted, it's like, oh my God, will you just get out of here already? Oh, if I have to serve one more person. It'll change your perspective when you're just helping out and burnt out. What do we gain by keeping the requirements and walking mournfully before the Lord of hosts? And now he says, the arrogant are even blessed. Man, you're looking at other people going, man, look at all them. And not only the evildoers are even prospering, and they even test God and escape. I mean, helping out, it'll eventually come to the end of yourself. You'll burn out. It'll change your perspective on people, the people that you're supposed to value. You're supposed to be serving. It'll change you. Because there's a difference, you guys, between helping and serving. You're not a guest. If you're a disciple, if you're a Christian, hey, if this is your home, you're not a guest here. You don't check in and check out. You're part of the house. This is your house, your family. You belong. There's a difference between helping and serving. So let me show you now picking up that story in Mark chapter 10, kind of the benefits of serving when you can quit helping out and start serving, man. In Mark chapter 10, we continue the story where James and John, they didn't get it. They kind of said, oh yeah, do what we say, Lord. Let me sit at your left and let my brother sit at your right. And we pick up the story. Jesus says, you know that the rulers in this world, they lord it over their people. Like that's what they want. They want the position. They want the status. And the officials flaunt their authority over those under them. But among you, hey, church, among you, hey, disciple, hey, Christian, among you, Jesus says, it'll be different. Hey, you're called to be different. I didn't call you just to help weak people or to fix broken stuff. I didn't call you. No. I called you to be different because even whoever wants to be a leader among you must be a servant. And whoever wants to be first among you must be the slave of anyone else. He says, because even me, the Son of Man, I came not to be served, but to serve. That's the example that I gave you. To serve. To see the value in every person. Every addict. Every prostitute. Every beggar. Every lame and broken. To see the value. To serve people. And to give my life as a ransom to many. So if you can just quit helping out and quit seeing yourself as a transactional relationship in the body of Christ and actually get a revelation that you're a son and a daughter of the house, well, you can start serving. And then you can start experiencing the true benefits that come. Not when you help out. When you help out, you need to quit that. But with serving, God has some. He created you with benefits. Like when you actually serve, something happens, not only in the people you serve, but inside of you, something happens. Take some notes. Number one, here's what happens. Serving provides you with purpose and fulfillment. That's what serving provides. You'll never get that helping out because distance, because you can't, you'll never get it just by helping out. You'll need to serve and be connected to and see the value in. And a lot of people try to find their purpose and fulfillment in other places. They will. And a lot of you have tried to find it in other places, but God has created you very uniquely, very specifically, that there is a part of you that will never be whole, that will never find purpose and meaning and fulfillment until you start serving God by serving others. It's the way God created you. 1 Peter chapter 1 says that God knew you and chose you long ago. Do you guys know that? Not only were you created to serve, but God chose you to serve him. You need to receive that because some of you think that you're not ready to serve God. You're not qualified to serve God. You don't know enough to serve God. You haven't been, you know, in church long enough to serve God. That has nothing to do with your experience. It has to do with what God has created you for. See, you don't even have to believe in Jesus to understand this. Listen to me. Here at Discovery, you can belong before you believe. And I challenge you, if you don't believe and you're still testing out faith, to test this one out right here. Start serving God by serving others even before you even believe in him. And see if you will not be filled with purpose and fulfillment. Amen. Just test that. Because God created you. He created you this way, wired you to actually receive this purpose and fulfillment this way. 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 10 actually says he gave you the tools for it as well. God has given each of you a gift from his great variety of spiritual gifts. Use them well to serve one another. To serve one another. You haven't been created to simply help, you guys. You have. You have been created to serve. That's God made you that way. Here's the second thing that you need to know about serving. That is, serving nourishes your soul. It's nourishment to your soul. Okay, listen, God wired you this way. That some of you, your soul is starving in this area. It needs the nourishment that only serving God can provide. All right? And you may read your Bible. You may have devotion. You may have prayer. You may have some worship. You may even have community. Those are great things. And it is going to add value to your life. Absolutely. But there is a part of your inner life, of your inner health, of your soul that will not be nourished unless you serve God. He wired you this way. Some of you are starving for it. And again, it can't come by just helping out. It can't come. It only can come by serving God. You know what? Helping out is also incurs a debt. When you help someone, they owe you something. But when you serve, there is no debt owed. No debt to someone you serve. Jesus said in John chapter 4, it said, meanwhile, the disciples were urging Jesus to eat. He had been serving, you know, for days. Just serving, serving, serving. Hey, Jesus, you're hungry, you should eat. No, he said, I have some food that you don't know anything about. Jesus explained, my nourishment comes from doing the will of God who sent me and from finishing his work. He said, there is a nourishment in my life that you guys don't know about. What gives me passion, what gives me energy, what gives me drive to keep going is something this world cannot give. That when I'm serving my Father and accomplishing his will for my life, it nourishes my soul like food cannot give me. It nourishes you guys. It does. A few things about this, little subpoints here, let me give you, because serving is the antidote to self-absorption. This is what it does to your soul. Because really, this is, again, a cultural thing. It's in our culture, man. We're very self-absorbed, self-seeking, people. It just serving, though, others is the antidote to that self-seeking, self-absorbed lifestyle that is all over our culture. It's infiltrated the church. There are three primary cultural influences when it comes to self-absorption. They're not in your notes, but let me give them to you. These three primary prevalent in our culture: individualism, secularism, and narcissism. Serving is the antidote to all three of these prevalent mindsets that are in our culture today. Individualism says, I've got to do what's best for me. I got to do me. You do you, I'm going to do me. I got to do what's best for me. That's individualism. Secularism says, God doesn't matter. Like, I believe in God. Like, there's a God, but it doesn't matter. He's not concerned with my daily life, what I'm doing or not doing. He handles the big stuff, not the little stuff. So, God, you stay on your side of the fence. I'm going to stay on my side of the fence. God, you take care of your business. I take care of my business. A lot of Christians live their life that way. God, you take care of, like, you got your business, God, but this is my business, my daily life. I mean, you're only concerned with the big stuff in my life, so this is my daily life. You're not concerned with all that stuff. That's secularism. And narcissism says all that matters is me. All I'm concerned about is my goals, my dreams, my fulfillment, my happiness, my career, my money, my future. It's my. We measure everything by this question: what's in it for me? What's it? Serving is the antidote to this mindset that is so prevalent in our culture. Also, serving provides health benefits. Serving provides health benefits. And this is so cool about God, man. I just love this about God, because not only has he created us to serve, and he's commanded us to serve, he's chosen us to serve, he's called you into the family to serve, like you belong in the house, but then he's created like these benefits along with serving. Like there are literal health benefits. It's proven scientifically. I was reading the long-term benefits of volunteering and serving, that actually mental health, like they've associated mental health and emotional health to those who actually are long-term serving and volunteering. Happiness is linked to it. Longevity of life is linked to serving others. How good is our God, man, that he would wire you in such a way that not only you would be nourished and your soul would be nourished, but there would be actual health benefits in you doing what God has called you to do, and not just helping out or fixing people and fixing things, but serving others. Serving others provides some health benefits. Here's the last one I'm going to share with you guys this morning. Number three is that serving is joining God's plan to reach your community. That is God's plan to reach our community, not by helping weak people or fixing broken people. No, but seeing the value in every soul, in every person, and serving them. That is God's plan to reach our community. One author said that the local church is the hope of the world. The local church is the hope of the world. That's God. It's God's plan. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 says this. We urge you, brothers and sisters, to warn those who are idle and disruptive, and encourage the disheartened, help the weak, and be patient with everyone. Galatians chapter 6 says, carry each other's burdens, and in this way, you will fulfill the law of Christ. Like, serve one another. And he's saying, if you just serve one another, carry one another's burdens, you're going to fulfill God's law, the law of Jesus. Because the church, you guys, is God's plan A, and there is no plan B. There is no. That's God's plan A. When Jesus came and he raised from the dead and he went to heaven, he instituted this thing called the local church. Maybe we've let culture influence us and how we operate in it. Maybe the church is still God's plan A. Maybe it's not time to give up on church, you guys. Maybe it's time to get back to the original design of what God intended the body of Christ to be. Because it's still God's plan A, and there is no plan B. The local church is the hope of the world. 1 Peter chapter 2 says, but you, hey church, you're a chosen people. God chose you for this. You're a royal priesthood. That means like you're part of the family of God. You're royalty. You're sons and daughters, heirs, the Bible says, of the promise of the kingdom of heaven. A holy nation, God's special possession, that you may declare the praises of him who's called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. Because once you were a guest, once you were on the outside looking in, you weren't a people, but now you're part of the family. But now you belong. Now you are a people of God. You're not a guest in God's house. You're not a guest anymore. If you're a child of God, you're a Christian, you're a disciple, quit helping out and start serving. And even if you don't go here to Discovery, hey, here's what I encourage you to do. Find a place and go all in. Don't treat it as a transaction. Don't treat yourself even as a guest when God has called you a son. Don't treat yourself as a guest when God has called you a daughter. Go all in. This is your house.
Hey, thanks for joining in for our Quit Church series. We hope you enjoyed it. Make sure you come back for the next installment in this series.